and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood.
Oh, glory! Glory! Glory to God! Glory to God! Glory! Glory to him! Praise his name! Praise his name! Hallelujah! We are set free. Hebrews 11, verses 8 through 13. I hope this is encouraging to you. You guys can be seated right there. I put this little message is called Want More Faith? Here's how. I always want more faith. Because I complain all the time about all the stuff that God gives to me because I have to store it and clean it out and program it and all that. But I'm lying. I like stuff. You like stuff. Amen? I think I'll write a song. Want more stuff, Lord. Hebrews 11, 8 through 13. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place which he was to receive as an inheritance. And he went out, not knowing where he was to go. We don't always have the crossings of the T's and the dotting of the I's. We're not always going to have that. But here's the secret. Well, how could he do that? By faith, he sojourned in the land of promise, as in a foreign land, living in tents with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. I tell you this all the time. Hang out with godly people. That was Abraham's promise, but as long as those that went with him stayed with him, it became their promise too. His nephew became as blessed as he was. In fact, they became so blessed, the land couldn't support them, so they had to split up and go separate ways. So God knows what he's doing when he says, don't seek or hang out with the ungodly. Amen. They'll get you in trouble every time. Well, you are your own canvas. God's got something special for you. Heirs with him of the same promise, for he looked forward to the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. That's what we've got to look forward to. By faith, Sarah herself also received strength to conceive seed. She was a century old, and she bore a child when she was past the age, because she judged him faithful, who had promised, therefore, from one man, and him as good as dead, were born as many as the stars of the sky in multitude. Abraham. He was an old codger. And he didn't have to take all the fancy stuff that you see advertised on TV today. He said, I'm going to give you an heir. And you're gonna multiply as the stars in the sky. Innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Generations are in bad shape today because their predecessors, their ancestors, just didn't get it. I remember when I got saved and God expected me to witness to my family. And I said, why me? And he said, well, we got to start somewhere. And sure enough, little by little by little by little, after a lifetime of preaching at funerals, grandma's funeral, grandpa's funeral, mom's funeral, all the family, aunts and uncles that I had grown up with, little by little by little, I took him back for Jesus with God's help. So here's the question. If faith pleases God, and the Bible very frankly says it does, then faith should take priority in every believer's life. Faith should be the priority in our life. Faith for healing. Faith for deliverance. Amen. Faith for carrying the word forth to a lost world and to a lost family, frankly. Most of our families are lost without Jesus. It was by faith that he went off into a strange land. A land he didn't understand. It was not a welcoming thing. It was not a comfortable thing. We're pretty assured that he came from a wealthy background. He probably lived pretty high on the hog. All of a sudden, he's living in tents. He's traveling like a nomad. He says in verse 13 that he confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. We're strangers. We're pilgrims here. There's nothing here that should have our hearts. Nothing. Except Jesus.
Amen.
Except Jesus. I shared this yesterday. Most of you know the story of Amy Simple McPherson. I think she was about 4'2", 4'3", little lady. Went to China, pregnant with her first child. Her husband got sick in China and died. Don't ever think that you're alone. The Spirit began to stir Amy up and said, I need for you to go back to America. I've got a great work for you to do. And she says, Lord, I have no money. But you can count on God's people. There were two little sisters who were intercessors. Don't even remember their names. I have to go back and get the book on Amy, and it's recorded there, and I should do that because they deserve to be mentioned. But that's what happens so often. The people out front get the credit. The people behind the scenes, we don't even know who they are. But the Holy Spirit come upon them and drove them to their knees, and they begin to pray, and they said, you know what? The Spirit spoke to my heart and said, Amy needs money. And they both sent her enough money to get her back to America, and the rest is history. She traveled this depression-ridden country. I think it was about a 1922 Cadillac, this little four-foot lady with a circus tent. And when the winds would come up, her and her helpers could barely get the tent up, but she kept on trucking, as that used to say. Remember the big feet? You had the belt. Frankie got me a belt. Says, keep on trucking. I still have that. And she ended up building Angela's Temple in the middle of the worst depression that this nation has ever experienced. Because she dared trust God. By faith, she said, if God said it, I believe it. That's what we need to get a hold of today. So how are one of the ways that we get more faith? By separation from the world. They'll mess it up every time. Well, you don't know the friends that I have. You don't know the friend I have. I have a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. Your friends won't ever do that. And I'll guarantee you something. When you follow the ways of your friend, you will never succeed in what God has called you to do because they don't have a clue. It's not their call. In fact, they'll argue with you. This is about you and God and getting more faith. By faith, he sojourned in the land of promise and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. You gotta say, Lord, nothing on this earth holds my interest anymore. Only you.
Amen.
Only you. TV? No. Movies? No. Only you, Lord. I'm going to give you my time and my energy. This is not my final home. I'm just a pilgrim passing through. So we get more faith when we separate ourselves from this world. Come out from among them and be ye separate. If you don't get anything today, Jesus has to be number one in your life. Amen. When I graduated high school, guess how much I weighed? Nope. 128 pounds. What happened to you, Gary? The world. Friends said you gotta go to Max's and you gotta go to Cabrera's and you gotta go to El Sombrero and look at me. We gotta separate ourselves from the world. The word sojourn, probably in your Bible, means to be beside but not with. We sojourn in the world, we don't have to be a part of the world. The word pilgrim, you know, we get all uptight. If you're a racist, you got a problem. The word pilgrim means resident alien. There's big turmoils over illegal aliens. Well, we're illegal aliens. This is not our home. We're just passing through. Amen. We are to live in this world, but our hearts are to be in heaven. Heaven is our true homeland. The world should see the difference in us, church. That's what I've been hooting and hollering about for the past 3 months. A difference that is opposite of that of the world. We shouldn't look like the world, act like the world, smell like the world. A difference in our speech. A difference in our ways. In everything that we do, we should be making an impact. People should say, there goes an alien. Yeah. A Christian. There goes somebody that has their heart in a heavenly country. Christians being in the world, but not part of it. Being a sojourner and a pilgrim. Maintaining a position of separation from things of this world. We can contaminate it. This world will contaminate you. Contaminates your speech, your clothes, your actions, your attitude. So the main thought of this message today is separation from the things of this world helps us to get more faith. And faith is vital. We live by faith. Faith pleases God. Faith heals. Faith delivers. Faith sustains. Without faith and without God, we could not make it. Remember when I started the service, I thought my dad was going to live forever. Well, he didn't live forever. But I knew Jesus. I had found Jesus. And he replaced my dad. I can throw my arms around Jesus. I can feel the comfort that I used to get from those arms of my father on that cold winter night. And I rest assured that he will never leave me or forsake me. Never. Never. And the very Jesus that has sustained me, I introduced my father, who I thought was going to live forever, to that same Jesus. And sure enough, he came through, and my dad is waiting for me today because of Jesus. You see what I'm saying? So we have victory even over death. Jesus defeated death. Jesus' resurrection was the first fruits of our resurrection. How do I know your dad and mom are going to resurrect? Because Jesus, that I have my faith in, he resurrected first. Hallelujah. So all life does, all that blank canvas that I talked about does, it exercises our faith and helps us to maintain a constant position of separation from the ways of this sin-laden world. What did this world ever do for any of us? Nothing. If I was over at Set Free today and was preaching this message, every drug addict that was bound by $300 or $400 a day habit would be standing up praising God and clapping because they know what they've been delivered from. We must never forget what God delivered us from. Never. He really is the God of the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, 123rd, 367th chance. And we're living proof of that. Every one of us are living proof of that. If I would have done to so-called friends in my lifetime what I've done to Jesus, they would have written me off a long time ago. He never did write me off. That old song, I don't want to sing it, but that old song, I used to sing it for you. Standing somewhere in the shadows, you'll find Jesus. He's the only friend who cares and understands. Standing somewhere in the shadows, you'll find Jesus and you'll know Him by the nail prints in His hand. I ain't got no friends that's got nail prints in their hands. Well, I take that back. My best friend has scars all over his body. Beaten for my diseases and my sicknesses and my infirmities. I'm telling you, there's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. One look at Jesus and you'd say, I could be healed in a split second. You got to get your eyes off of this world and get them on Jesus. By His stripes, I'm healed. Not sorta, kinda, wish that was true. I'm healed in Jesus' name, but so are you. So are you. And so is the world. The world doesn't know what we know. But they'd like to know what we know. If the world knew what I know, we would be full of wheelchairs, crutches, casts. You don't come up and pray for people because your faith wavers. You got to get your faith on Jesus and in Jesus today, church. I still believe that you're going to see this church filled to overflowing. When we get this deep in our spirit, when we get this deep down in our conscience, that we can set the captives free, that His vision and focus and mission is ours, you will not be able to keep them out of here. They're going to bring every kind of infirm, sickness, disease. Better not have a weak stomach, because that's what we've been called to do. Oh, I'm excited about Jesus. Amen.